go on to the advantages of building a house. Right. Home ownership is a form of forced saving towards an asset that may increase value. So once you have built your house, with time, it can actually increase its value. And if the markets are good, you can sell it and buy another one. So it's a form of saving, right? You always make the decision about the use of the house. So unlike renting, you actually decide whether you want to throw a party or you want to open a shop, do a business. That's your house. You have a right to decide on whatever you want to do with the house, right? And then you get to choose the design and features of the house. So when building or when drafting a plan, you actually come up with your own designs, with your own features that you want to include in the house. And you can actually renovate the house and make it even much better from what it was from the beginning. So building your own house means you also do not inherit somebody else's problems. That is in comparison with buying a house. Once somebody sells the house, you don't even know why they are selling the house. So it means maybe they are selling it because there are problems. And then what do? You inherit those problems, right? And then new houses are built in areas that are growing rather than declining, meaning that house will what? Will appreciate in value. It will keep increasing the value. And then, like I said, you can use it as an asset that you can sell, get money, and buy another house, or maybe build another one, right? It is also personally satisfying. That means you have come up with something that you designed yourself, right? All the ideas, the design features are coming from you. So you are personally satisfied with that house because it's you who actually designed it, right? And then we go on to the disadvantages of building a house, right? Generally, it is more expensive than buying. There is a lot that you put in when you are building a house. The building materials and everything is just a daunting task, right? So building is more complicated and it might take even longer, right? And also there are many or there may be unexpected costs, right? Some other things might come up during the time when you're building. So those are the costs that we don't expect, right? And most new neighborhoods are on the outskirts of the city. Sometimes outskirts of the city means you are far away from the shopping centers. You might also be far away from the schools for your children. So that's another disadvantage, right? And factors such as job loss and interest rate increases may affect ability to keep making mortgage repayments, and you may lose your property. So within that period when you are building, you might lose your job, right? And then how do you pay your mortgage? It means you can actually lose your property. Or sometimes the interest rates keep fluctuating or they go up, and then it means it gets even more and more expensive to build a house, right? And the last point says you are required to pay rates and taxes. The charges for water, for sewage and drainage services. So these are some of the other costs that come with building a house. Right? And then we go to our third option, which is buying a home. Right. So when you are buying a home, there is two options again. There is what you call the full title ownership and the sectional title ownership. So full title means you own the ground and the house all on your own, right? That is the legal owner of the entire property. You become the legal owner of the entire property consisting of the land and the structure that is built on. So when you are talking about a full title ownership, we are apparently talking about what you call standalone houses, a house that is standing alone without being attached to another house or another building. So it's called full title ownership or a standalone house. You've got the house, you've got a yard around the house that you don't share with anybody else. So we call it full title ownership or standalone house. Right? And then you can also buy what you call a sectional title ownership. That is the legal owner of any section of a housing complex. So if we're talking about sectional title, it means you're only owning a section of that particular house. That could be maybe if you've bought a flat, it means you are owning part of the flat. You share the staircases, the walls, and other common areas with other people. So that's why we call it a sectional title. So in a sectional title, there are common areas. Sometimes we find sectional title ownerships in, like I've mentioned, flats or some other complexes. If you buy a house in a complex, then it means you own a section of that house. You share the common areas with other people. If there is a swimming pool without that complex, if there is gardens and lawns, then it means you share the gardens with other people. Right. And so again, within that sectional ownership, it means the people who own the section actually have to contribute towards levies that are used to maintain the whole area. For example, they have to maintain the gardens. They make sure that there is security within that area. So everybody has to contribute towards maintaining the gardens, towards the security of that area, or maybe towards the maintenance of the pool that is within the area. Right. And then advantages of buying a home. You have your own house on your land, which gives you security of tenure. So that house is a standalone house. You've got your own land and you can do whatever you want in that property, right? And then you also become a legal owner of the property. So the property is yours, right? You can use it as security for a bank loan. Remember, when we need, sometimes when you apply for a loan from the bank, they need what we call collateral security, or we call it surety. So for them to give you that loan, you can actually submit the title deeds of your house so that they can use it after you have failed to pay the loan. They can actually sell the house and recover their money back, right? And then the unit can be sold to make profits. That's if the market conditions are favorable. What do we mean by market conditions? We are talking about the inflation rate. You can sell a house today and then you discover in the next few months you are no longer able to buy a house of the same value or something much better. That means if the markets are favorable, so you can sell your house and then buy something better and get some profit out of selling the house, right? And then again, if it's your own house, you can rent out a room and do what? And generate some income. So it is a form of, or it becomes a source of income for you. Sometimes some people could hardly pay their mortgages. Like, for example, if they've lost their jobs, they can actually rent out the entire house and stay in a cheaper area so that they are able to repay the mortgage loan to the bank, right? And then a business can be run from home to earn income, provided the local authority approves this. So the local authority, we're talking about the municipality around that area. So some municipalities do not allow people to run businesses within their residential areas. So that's if the local municipality or the local authority allows you to do so, then you can generate some income again by running a business in your own home, right? And then we go to the disadvantages of buying a home. What are the disadvantages, right? It's long-term financial commitment that you need to honor by making payments each month. So if you buy a home, you actually get a mortgage loan from the bank, and you have to pay that maybe within 20 or 25 years. That is actually a long-term financial commitment, of which some people might not be able to go through that time, right? And then property maintenance is your responsibility. So property maintenance, if it needs painting, you have to do it yourself. If you need security around your home, you do it yourself again. The gardens around the house have to be maintained, and that is your responsibility as a house owner, right? And bond repayments tend to be much more expensive than the rent. So sometimes that's why other people prefer to rent than buying their own houses, because the bond repayment might come very expensive, right? And then the safety and security is your responsibility again. That means, especially if it's in an area that there is a high crime rate, you would need to secure your home, and that becomes your responsibility, right? You have to pay municipal rates and taxes on the property. That means that's another cost that is on you, right? And then still on buying a home, we go to the financial considerations before buying a home or before buying a house. What is it that comes into your mind before you buy a house? There are certain things that we should think about. So the first one is, you decide what you need, right? What kind of a house do you need? So that is determined by the size of your family, which is the stage in the life cycle. What kind of a house do you need? If you've got children, let's say there is maybe two children in the house, then the parents, so probably you would maybe need a three-bedroomed or a four-bedroomed house. So that actually helps you to decide on what you need. What kind of a house do you need? That is determined by the size of the family, of this, or the stage in the life cycle. Sometimes some people are in what to call the empty nest stage, and they decide to buy a home. The empty nest stage is when all the birds have flown away from the nest. That is the children that I'm referring to. And we are only left with what? With mother and father in the house. So what does that mean? It means they just need a smaller home that they can be able to maintain, right? And then you also determine what you can afford. Affordability has to do with the amount of money that you have. We also discussed about people failing to pay their mortgage loans. So are you able to pay that amount of mortgage in the long term? So you also determine what you can afford. You just need to buy something you can afford. And then you also find and inspect the house. So go around, or we shop around actually, look at different houses, go there, inspect the house, and then when you are satisfied that this is the kind of house that you want, then you can consider buying the house. Right? Then buying a house also comes with contractual aspects. So there are certain contracts that are signed before you buy a house. So there is what we call an offer to purchase. You submit an offer to purchase agreement that shows the amount you are offering to pay for the property and other conditions of sale. So if somebody is selling a house, the buyer actually comes with an offer to purchase. So once you submit an offer to purchase to the seller might agree on your offer, or they might make a counter offer, or they can refuse it outright. So there is three options there. You come up with an offer to purchase, submit it to the seller agrees on it, or they make a counter offer, or they reject it outright. So what happens is, if somebody is selling a house, let's say it's for 2.2 million, right? 2.2 million, and then when you give them an offer to purchase, obviously most of the times we want to negotiate. Maybe you say, I've got only 2 million. So you write and you give them an offer to purchase of 2 million, right? If they want to make a counter offer, they would actually say, okay, I'll give you, I would rather take 2.1. Or they would actually say, no, I refuse to take this. Or they would actually agree to the 2 million that you are offering them. Right. And then after the seller has agreed to or has signed the offer to purchase, both the seller and the buyer actually sign after they've agreed that. So after signing, it becomes a deed of sale agreement. This is when both the seller and the buyer have signed the offer to purchase document. It becomes a contract called a deed of sale. So the deed of sale actually comes with the amount that the house is being sold for. It comes with the name of the purchaser, their ID number, the name of the seller, their ID number, and it also comes with a lot of things. It gives the address of the house. This is an agreement to sell house number so and so on a stand number this and this, a 4-bedroomed house of this and that. So it contains some of those details. That becomes a deed of sale, which is a contract, right? Once it is signed, it becomes a contract, right? And then after the deed of sale, then comes the home finance agreements. So once your offer to purchase letter has been accepted, you will need to find finance from the financial institutions. So the financial institutions, we are talking about the banks, right? And then we have got two types of those agreements. We have got a non-mortgage loan agreement and a mortgage loan agreement, right? So the non-mortgage loan agreement is a housing loan without a mortgage bond, a security, right? Remember, learners, when we go to the bank, like I said, to ask for a loan, they need what we call collateral security, something that the bank is going to hold on to. When you fail to pay back their money, then they can actually get their money in another form. That is what we call collateral security. So on non-mortgage loan agreements, the security could be your pension. They use your pension as your security or your provident fund. So what does that mean? It means that it has to be somebody that has an income, or somebody that is employed actually has pension or provident fund. Then the bank actually takes the pension, or is going to take your pension, as collateral security. Or I say the other name that we use is called surety, that the bank holds on to. So non-mortgage loan agreements, and then we have got mortgage home loan agreements. That is banks like Absa, Standard Bank, and FNB usually offer mortgage home loans, right? So the mortgage is secured on immovable property. That is the house that you are buying at that particular time. The house belongs to the what? To the bank, until you are done paying their mortgage loan, then it will belong to you. So remember, non-mortgage loan agreements and mortgage loan agreements. So on immovable property, we are talking about the house that you are buying, or some people use land. If you own a land, then you use it as surety to get a mortgage loan from the bank. And then we also have got what we call deposits. If you are buying a house, you should be able to put down a certain amount. So this is the amount of money required to give in advance to show your intentions to purchase, or your intentions of purchase. So you put down a certain amount in terms of deposit. So the more deposit you put, the less installment you pay. The less deposit you put, or the more installments that you pay. So if you've got money, say you are buying a house for 2 million and then you've got 1 million deposit, then it makes your life easier. You will pay a lesser amount in terms of the mortgage installments, right? And then we also have got interest. This is the money that the bank charges you for the amount you have borrowed, right? So remember, we said interest is the cost of borrowing money. So once you get a mortgage loan from the bank is a business that needs to make money. So on that particular amount that they've borrowed you, they charge interest, right? This may be fixed or variable interest. Fixed means the interest that does not change. It remains the same. Even if interest rates go up or go down, you still pay the same amount. It is fixed, right? And then the variable interest rates keep on changing, or they fluctuate according to the interest rate changes, or according to inflation. So once the interest rates are lower, then you are likely to benefit. If they are higher, then it means you would pay more, right? And then we go on to what you call the initiation fees. We still under buying a home, learners, right? This is a once-off fee charged by the bank for setting up the home loan account. So that is an initiation fee. They open an account for you, or they open a home loan account for you, and they charge you the initiation fees. That is for setting up that account for you. So also the fee for evaluating the property is included in the initiation fees. You don't just sell your property, or you don't just buy property. It has to be evaluated first by the bank to see how much it costs. So that is the evaluation fee, is also added to the initiation fees. Right. And then we also have got what you call the bond registration cost. So you register your bond, right? If you obtained a mortgage bond, it needs to be registered against the property at the deeds office by an attorney nominated by the bank. So remember, we said it's contractual factors that we are looking at. It has to do with a contract. So buying a house, you cannot just buy a house like you are buying a loaf of bread from the supermarket. There is a lot that is involved. Sometimes that's why people get scammed. You can't just buy a house directly from the owner without involving lawyers, guys, right? So you have to have an attorney who actually registers the bond of your house. So if, like we said, if you obtained a mortgage bond, it needs to be registered against that property that you are buying, right? At the deeds office by an attorney. An attorney is a lawyer that is nominated by the bank, right? And then the other thing is insurance. So you protect the structure and permanent fixtures against fire, floods, and other disasters, right? So in case a fire breaks up, the house is insured, then the insurance will pay you back. And then we also have got an insurance that actually insures the bond or the loan that you are paying. In case something happens to you, you die before even finishing paying the house, then the insurance should be able to do what? To pay the bank. Remember, guys, buying a house again, you actually buy the house, you borrow money from the bank pays the seller the full amount, and then what do? You pay back the money to the bank in installments and with interest, right? And then we also have got what to call transfer duty. That is a government tax levied on the buyer of the property to be transferred into their name. So for the house to be transferred into your name, you also have to pay a certain tax that is levied against who? The buyer of the house. Usually it's it's between 10 to 20% of the amount of the house or of the value of the property that you are buying, right? And then the other one is the title deed. A title deed is the document that reflects the ownership details and details of the property. So it means the name of the buyer has been transferred and they are the rightful owner of the house. They actually own the house. They've got what you call the title deeds. But most of the times you don't receive the title deeds. They are kept by the bank's attorney until you are done paying the house. Then you can receive the title deeds, right? And then we also have got what you call Government Housing Subsidies. These are the RDP houses that we know, right? This is a housing subsidy, is a grant that the government provides to low-income consumers to help them acquire housing, right? So who qualifies for a housing subsidy, or who qualifies to have or to own an RDP house, right? It's either you are married or permanently living together with your partner, then you can be able to acquire an RDP house. Also, it's only for the citizens of the Republic of South Africa and not any other people, right? And for you to get an RDP house, you need to be 21 years of age, and your total monthly household income does not exceed 3,500 rand, right? And if you have not previously owned a house, then you would qualify for a housing subsidy, right? And then, learners, we go on to the activities that I've prepared for you. One question one says, answer the questions below, right? 1.1 reads, name two costs that are included in the bond registration fees, right? And then 1.2 reads, explain why monthly levies must be taken into account when buying sectional title property. I'm sure you still remember when we discussed about sectional title property. That is when you only own a section of that house. The other areas are common areas that you share with the people that live in that complex. You share the staircases, that's if it's a flat. You share the walls, you share the swimming pools, you also share the gardens, right? And then the next one, 1.3 says, explain the following terms. That is a mortgage bond, a deed of sale agreement. And then 1.4 says, state who is responsible for making the rules and regulations in a sectional title complex. Right, learners, I'll give you about 2 minutes to answer the questions. Welcome back, learners. I'm sure you are done with the activity. We'll start with the solutions. 1.1, the question was, name two costs that are included in the bond registration fees. So we said we engage an attorney. So that is the attorney's fees or the lawyer's fees for drawing up the bond documents. And then also registering of the bond. We have got also the taxes, the stamp duty. They also pay VAT and postage. So those are the answers that I was expecting from you, right? Then 1.2 reads, explain why monthly levies must be taken into account when buying sectional title property. So our answer says levies must be paid every month, and they are compulsory. What did we say we need the levies for? We need the levies to maintain the property that you share with the other people. Maybe you need to paint the walls, you need to maintain the garden, or if there is a lift, that lift has to be maintained all the time. If there is a swimming pool around that you share with other people, then you pay levy against the maintenance of that particular area. We also talked about security within the sectional title. So you also pay for the security of that particular area. So levies must be paid every month and they are compulsory, right? And then levies may increase every year due to inflation again. So that's something that you must take into account before buying a sectional title property. And then the buyer must budget for levies and also ensure that they can or they are able to pay the levies, right? And then we go on to our 1.3, says explain the following terms, right? That is, we go to the answers for 1.3.1, says mortgage bond, right? What is a mortgage bond? It is a loan or money that is secured on immovable property and gives rights over a property, right? That's what you call the mortgage bond. That is the money that we secure from the bank on immovable property. If you remember, we said immovable property could be the house that you are buying or the land that you own, right? Or it could be money that is borrowed over a property loan made to the property owner where the property is the security to the loan. So if you are buying a house, then you use that particular house as collateral security to the bank, so that once you fail to pay your mortgage bond, then the house will, the bank will recover the money by selling that particular house, right? And then we've got what you call the deed of sale agreement, right? It is a formal written agreement or the terms and conditions between the buyer and the seller of the property. So we call it a deed of sale agreement. Remember when we talked about the deed of sale agreement, we said firstly, when you want to buy a house, you give the seller an offer to purchase. And then once they agree, or once the two of you agree, you sign up, and then we call that a deed of sale. It becomes a contract that is signed up with the details of the seller and the buyer of the house. Right. And then our 1.4 says state who is responsible for making rules and regulations in the sectional title complex. So we have got what you call a body corporate. They are the ones that make the rules or that come up with the rules and the regulations of that particular complex that you are staying in. So a body complex has got representatives or is made out of representatives of people that stay within that complex, so that they come together and decide on how to secure the complex where they are living in. Right. And then we go on to activity two, learners. 2.1 says match the words in the box with the statements below. Right? So I'm going to read the words for you. We have got the first one is bond, then deposit, and then mortgage, and then bond protection, security, that's bond protection security, and then we have got fixed interest rate, and then we have got transfer duties, we have got conveyance fees, and initiation fees. Right, and our question 2.1.1 reads, a home loan repayment remains constant and you are protected against upward fluctuations. And 2.1.2 reads, the fee that is charged by the attorney who draws up the bond document. Right, I'll give you just a minute, learners, to go through the words there and also the questions below. Right, welcome back, learners. We continue with our questions of matching the words in the box with the statements. So 2.1.3 reads, tax collected by the receiver of revenue. And then 2.1.4 reads, the down payment made at the time of purchase. And 2.1.5 reads, fees that must be paid before the bond is registered. And 2.1.6 is a loan made to the owner of property where the property is the security for the loan. Right, I'll give you 2 minutes, learners, to answer these questions. Right, welcome back, learners. We go to the solutions of our questions. 2.1.1 says a home loan repayment remains constant and you are protected against upward fluctuations. So we said it's fixed interest rates. So fixed interest rates do not change. They remain the same. Even if the interest rate goes up or goes down, it still remains the same, right? We also said besides fixed interest rates, we have got variable interest rates. Variable are the ones that keep fluctuating or changing. When the interest rate goes up, they also go up. If it goes down, they also go down, right? 2.1.2 reads, the fee that is charged by the attorney who draws up the bond document. We call that the conveyance fees. Right? And then we go to 2.1.3 says the tax that is collected by the receiver of the revenue on behalf of the government is called the transfer duty. The transfer duty or the tax that is charged is when the name of the house is transferred into the buyer's name so that it becomes legally their property. Right? And then 2.1.4 reads the down payment made at the time of purchase. This one is called a deposit. You make a down payment towards purchasing the property. The more deposit you pay, the less mortgage you pay. The less deposit you pay, that is also the more of the mortgage you are going to pay. Right? And 2.1.5 reads, fees that must be paid before the bond is registered. We call it the initiation fees. Right? And 2.1.6, a loan made to the owner of the property where the property is the security for the loan. We call it a mortgage loan. Remember, learners, we looked at the mortgage loan and the non-mortgage loan. And we said on the non-mortgage loan, what do they use as security? We said they use the pension or the provident fund. That is, it means that person has to be employed. Right, learners? Now we go to the summary of our lesson. We said rent is a tenure option in which a tenant signs a lease agreement with a lessor, which states the rental conditions and the rights and responsibilities of the tenant and the landlord. Right? And then we also said a building contract must be in writing and signed by the owner and the builder. And the other one was a registered builder must issue the owner with a standard home builder's warranty to the homeowner. Right? And we also said freehold title or a freestanding house is a form of tenure in which a person is the legal owner of the entire property, including land and structure built on it. Right? And then a housing subsidy is a grant that government provides to low income consumers to assist them to get housing. Right, learners, we have come to the end of our lesson. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next lesson.